From New York, this is Democracy Now!
There's been an uptick in private sector strikes, as well as a ballooning number of people quitting their jobs in the United States, unlike anything we've seen in a very long time.
From Kellogg's to John Deere, thousands of workers are on strike across the United States in what some have described as Striketober. We'll get the latest and speak to a striking worker at John Deere. Plus, we look at why a group of taxi drivers in New York are launching a hunger strike to demand debt relief for thousands of drivers. Buffalo, New York, to speak with Democratic mayoral candidate India Walton.
I think that for a person to expect that my children have a quality education, a healthy place to live, safe places to play, and access to clean air and water is very reasonable.
India Walton is a Black nurse and mother of four who's trying to become the first socialist mayor of a major American city in decades. But many top Democrats are refusing to endorse her, even though she won the Democratic primary, beating the four-term incumbent. The head of the New York Democratic Party is facing calls to resign after comparing her to former Ku Klux Klan leader David Duke. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. In Brazil, a leaked draft of a Senate report accuses far-right President Jair Bolsonaro of multiple crimes related to his mishandling of the pandemic, saying he should be charged with crimes against humanity. The Senate investigation finds he chose to let COVID-19 spread throughout the population in the hopes of achieving herd immunity. Brazil's recorded over 600,000 coronavirus deaths. The report blames the Bolsonaro administration's policies for over half of those. In the United States, the House committee investigating the January 6th Capitol insurrection has recommended a criminal contempt charge against Trump White House advisor Steve Bannon for defying a congressional subpoena. This is the committee's chair, Mississippi Congressmember Benny Thompson.
The rule of law remains under attack right now. If there are no accountability for these abuses, if there are different sets of rules for different types of people, then our democracy is in serious trouble.
At the White House, President Biden met with a group of Democratic lawmakers Tuesday, where he reportedly lowered the top-line price tag on the reconciliation bill yet again, saying it could be as low as $1.75 trillion, half of the $3.5 trillion Democrats were hoping to pass. Key climate programs and free community college are some of the provisions that could be dropped due to obstruction by conservative Democrats Joe Manchin and Kyrsten Sinema. Paid family leave could also be slashed, just 4 weeks down from a proposed 12 weeks. Congressmember Pramila Jayapal, chair of the Congressional Progressive Caucus, spoke after leaving the meeting with Biden.
At the end of the day, the idea that we can do these programs, a multitude of programs, and actually get them going so that they deliver immediate transformational benefits to people is what we're focused on.
On Monday, a Senate Appropriations Committee panel approved an additional $29 billion for the Pentagon, $10 billion more than was requested, bringing its annual budget to nearly $726 billion. That's more than twice the annual cost of the Build Back Better Act, even before any cuts. The Build Back Better Act would vastly expand the social safety net and combat the climate crisis, in large part by fairly taxing corporations and the wealthiest Americans. A group of Sunrise Movement climate activists are beginning a hunger strike outside the White House today to demand Congress and President Biden pass the climate crisis provisions in the reconciliation package. The youth activists made the decision to strike following news that Democrats could cut a key measure which would promote renewable energy to replace fossil fuels as a concession to Senator Manchin. In related news, a new report published by the UN Environment Program finds governments are planning to extract double the amount of fossil fuels between now and 2030 that would be consistent with the 2015 Paris Climate Accord's target of keeping global temperature rise below 1.5 degrees Celsius. in Michigan. Activists took peaceful direct action to shut down Enbridge's Line 5 pipeline. In May, Governor Gretchen Whitmer ordered Enbridge to shut down the tar sands oil pipeline, calling it a ticking time bomb. But they continued to operate, threatening the fragile waterway of the Straits of Mackinac and sovereign indigenous lands. This is a water protector speaking before cutting off the pipeline Tuesday.
Enbridge violates the public trust every second that Line 5 continues to operate. Enbridge repeatedly and knowingly violated the terms of the 1953 easement and failed to correct structural shortcomings in the Line 5 pipeline. Furthermore, Line 5 has already spilled 33 different times, totaling over 1.1 million gallons of oil.
Here in New York City, elected leaders joined activists at a press conference outside National Grid's headquarters protesting the North Brooklyn pipeline and proposed price hikes to 2 million New Yorkers' gas bills. This is New York City council member and Democratic candidate for Brooklyn Borough President Antonio Reynoso.
They decided to expend billions of dollars on infrastructure for natural gas, and then they want us, the ones that are going to be suffering because of their decisions, to pay the bill on the future harm to our health. And we want to stop that.
In more climate news, another UN report out this week warns the last three mountain glaciers on the African continent are receding so quickly that they could disappear altogether within the next two decades. 118 million people already living in poverty could face drought, floods, or extreme heat. African countries make up 17% of the global population, but are responsible for less than 4% of the world's greenhouse gas emissions. In Yemen, the UN is calling for a ceasefire in the city of Marib, where tens of thousands of civilians in need of medical care and other assistance are trapped as fighting intensifies between Saudi-backed Yemeni forces and Houthi rebels to seize control of the city. The Saudi-led coalition said it had recently killed at least 160 Houthi rebels in air raids. The UN also warned Yemen's economy is collapsing and its humanitarian crisis worsening, with more than 20 million Yemenis, or two-thirds of the population, in need of immediate humanitarian assistance. This comes as UNICEF's reporting at least 10,000 Yemeni children have been killed or injured throughout the brutal war in Yemen. This is a UNICEF spokesperson.
Four out of every five children need humanitarian assistance. That's 11 million. 400,000 suffer acute malnutrition, severe acute malnutrition. That means they are literally on death's door. More than 2 million are out of school, 4 million more at risk.
At least 14 refugees have died, and dozens of others have been reported missing in the Mediterranean Sea in recent days as people fleeing extreme poverty, violence, and the effects of the climate crisis continue to take the dangerous trek to Europe. Some 230 people were recently rescued off Spain's Balearic Islands. Meanwhile, the German humanitarian vessel Sea-Watch 3 led seven rescue missions on Sunday and Monday, rescuing dozens of refugees off the coast of Libya. In Chile, at least 450 protesters were arrested and two were reported dead as police clashed with thousands of people who took to the streets of Santiago and across Chile Monday. Protesters were marking the second anniversary of the massive uprising against the right-wing government of President Sebastián Piñera, his neoliberal policies and worsening economic inequality in Chile. The mobilizations in 2019 also triggered efforts to rewrite the Chilean constitution, which was created under the U.S.-backed dictator Augusto Pinochet. Recent protests come just 1 month before Chileans head to the polls to elect a new president. A group of Central American mothers searching for their children are in the United States this week to demand action to find their missing loved ones who disappeared on the journeys to the U.S. The mothers are also denouncing human rights violations against Central American migrants. Members of the caravan of mothers of disappeared migrants from Central America shared their testimonies with lawmakers in Washington, D.C. yesterday. Here in New York, a group of mothers gathered at a rally in Queens Tuesday night. This is Araceli de Mejia, a mother from El Salvador, who has been searching for her son Edwin Alexander since September 2012.
We mothers don't believe in borders. We have participated in different caravans. We have pushed for different petitions to find our children. We have done DNA tests with our governments in our home countries. But in El Salvador, no one has listened to us.
In other immigration news, unpublished data from Customs and Border Protection show arrests by the Border Patrol shot up to its highest level since 1986. Over 1.7 million people were detained along the U.S.-Mexico border during the 2021 fiscal year that ended in September. This according to analysis by The Washington Post. In Parkland, Florida, the families of the 17 people who were killed during the 2018 massacre at the Marjorie Stoneman Douglas High School have reached a $25 million settlement with the Broward County School District. Others who were wounded or survived the mass shooting were also part of the agreement. This comes as shooter Nicholas Cruz, a former student at the high school, is expected to plead guilty today to 17 counts of premeditated murder and 17 counts of attempted murder. Texas is one step closer to enacting a heavily gerrymandered redistricting plan after both chambers of the legislature approved the new map, sending the measure to Republican Governor Greg Abbott's desk for signing. The map severely diminishes the electoral voice of communities of color, giving disproportionate voting power to white Texans and Republicans. Texas also gained two House seats this year. The state's population growth is largely due to an increase in people of color, but Republicans still gave white voters effective control of the new districts. In Colorado, the family of Elijah McClain has reached a tentative settlement with the city of Aurora in a federal civil rights lawsuit over McClain's 2019 death. Elijah McClain, a 23-year-old black man, was tackled by police, placed in a chokehold, and later injected with a large amount of the powerful sedative ketamine. He died several days later. Separately from the settlement, three police officers and two paramedics were indicted last month on manslaughter and homicide charges. A recent investigation confirmed a pattern of racially biased policing and use of excessive force in the Aurora Police Department. And in New York City, a prominent statue of Thomas Jefferson will be removed from City Hall after a years-long push from Black and Latinx council members. This is Councilmember Adrienne Adams.
Thomas Jefferson was a slaveholder who owned over 600 human beings, African slaves, that he reaped the economic benefits of slave labor from. He maintained the notion that Black people were inferior to white people. I believe it's time for us as a city to turn the page and move forward.
And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman in New York, joined by Democracy Now! Co-host Juan Gonzalez in New Brunswick, New Jersey. Hi, Juan.
Hi, Amy, and welcome to all of our listeners and viewers across the country and around the world.
Well, we begin today's show with what a number of people are calling Striketober, as workers across the United States in a wide variety of industries are walking off the job. Thousands have gone on strike at food plants operated by Kellogg's, Nabisco and Frito-Lay over work hours, pay and benefits. Last week, more than 24,000 Kaiser Permanente healthcare workers in California authorized a strike. Now, 10,000 United Automobile Workers members at John Deere are also on strike, saying they were forced to work overtime while the company made record profits. The list goes on and includes more than 1,000 coal miners on strike at Warrior Met in Alabama, as we've covered here at Democracy Now! This comes as the union representing television and film production crews averted a strike of some 60,000 workers just hours before a midnight deadline Saturday, when it reached a tentative agreement with an association of Hollywood producers representing companies like Walt Disney, Netflix, and Amazon. The tentative deal brings members of the International Alliance of Theatrical Stage Employees higher pay, longer breaks, and better health care and pensions. Benefits. Some members say the deal doesn't go far enough, and about 40,000 members from 13 Hollywood locals must still approve the pact. These are two IATSE members in Los Angeles, costume maker Yuen Toussaint and Thomas Pixelon, who works in sound production and a video by More Perfect Union.
We take one break at 6 hours on the contracts that our unions negotiated long ago. they're trying not to actually have us break, because for them, if they don't break us for lunch, they pay a meal penalty. Those meal penalties haven't been updated since the mid-80s, so for them, it's pennies. They can make us work 10 hours, 11 hours straight and pay 4 to 5 meal penalties, but it doesn't affect them at the end of the day when it's Amazon and the show has a $300 million budget.
We see the big companies producing big budget projects, and we know that they're popular, they're selling, and they're people are watching it, but our crew who's working on those projects are getting paid like $5 to nearly $10 less an hour, just because it's new media.
For more on this U.S. strike wave, we're joined in Pittsburgh by Alex Press. Staff writer Jacobin, where one of her recent pieces is headlined, U.S. Workers Are in a Militant Mood. She's also host of a podcast about Amazon workers called Primer. In a few minutes, we'll also speak with a John Deere worker on strike in Iowa. And we'll talk with a representative of the taxi workers who are going on hunger strike in New York. But first, let's look at this strike that was averted, the IATSE workers, 60,000 of them. Alex Press, can you talk about IATSE and then go broader to Striketober?
Sure. Yeah. Thanks so much for having me, Amy. So this is a big story, as you said, based on sheer numbers, right? 60,000 IATSE members voted nearly 99% in favor of authorizing a strike, and 90% of eligible members cast ballots in that vote. That would have begun a strike on Monday that had they not reached that deal late on Saturday night. That strike would have been the largest one in the private sector in the United States since won by 74,000 workers at GM in 2007. So the numbers on that strike authorization vote reflect a charged up, mobilized membership. The reason for their sense of urgency, their willingness to risk losing a paycheck going on strike, is motivated by what was said in that video by the worker, the schedule of an IATSE member. Specifically, they're concerned with what's called turnaround times, which is the minimum amount of time a worker has from when she leaves work to when she is expected to be back. IATSE has secured 10-hour turnarounds in this tentative agreement, which is progress for some members who had 9 hours, but many members already had 10. And it's important to remember that in this industry, 12 and 14 hour days are the norm, but 18, even 20 hour days are not unheard of. So it's really important that workers have the time to commute home, to eat, to spend time with families, and to get a good night's sleep before having to commute back to work. So workers are saying, you know what, I've had 10 hours, it's not enough, we want 12. You know, the other thing people should keep in mind here is that the agreement is called tentative for a reason, right? Unions are democratic institutions, and it's up to the membership to decide whether they're going to ratify that agreement. These are definitely members who have concerns around other things like funding for pensions. The raises you mentioned for many members are only 3% a year, whereas currently inflation is 5%. Though for the lowest paid IATSE members, they've gotten a very significant raise. So, you know, this is a story to keep an eye on, right? The vote is not happening tomorrow. Members have to see the full details of the agreement, and then they'll vote on it and discuss it amongst each other. So as you said, though, there's a broader moment going on right now. There's the strike at John Deere, and you're going to have a worker on who's on strike. That's great. And there, too, the workers, you know, rejected this contract, this tentative agreement overwhelmingly because Deere has seen immense profits, most profitable year on record. Their CEO got 160% raise. And meanwhile, John Deere presented the workers with the ultimatum that they would have to actually accept concessions. So John Deere asked them, told them that new hires would not have pensions anymore. And so, again, you know, these are illustrative of a moment where workers are willing to fight back. Right. They understand they have more leverage right now. The labor market is tighter than usual. It's harder to replace them if they go on strike. And they're not willing to accept bad deals. And where they already have bad deals, if they're in unions, they're willing to try to fight to get what they've given up before back. That said, there's a flip side to that, which is,
Yeah, I'm sorry, Alex, I wanted to ask you about the impact of the relative newcomers to the industry, to the film and video industry. I'm talking about it used to be just the old Hollywood studios, but now we have these giant digital companies, Netflix, Amazon, and Apple that are pouring billions into the production of content. How have these new forces affected the labor conditions? Obviously, there are more workers, but how have they affected the overall labor conditions of the industry?
Yeah, so it's a couple things. First, they've sort of sped up the amount of work that's happening, right? So everyone knows that plenty of people during the pandemic were at home binging Netflix, right? These streamers, as they're called, these streaming platforms, just have an immense amount of demand for content. They're trying to churn it out. And that then is translated to the workers themselves, who are constantly sort of being moved from project to project. And importantly, the way that it is allowed for them to have worse working conditions, to be sped up, as it were, as we might say in the labor movement, is that these companies have different agreements with IATSE. In 2009, they struck a deal with IATSE when these were still experiments, right? Netflix was just barely out of the time of being something that was mailing you a DVD at home, right? So these were not the enormous behemoths they are now. And there was an agreement struck that said workers would need to be more flexible here. I think the wording was that these are uncertain economies. And so that a deal was agreed upon. That said, also in that agreement said, when things have changed, if these companies prove profitable, both parties will recognize that and this agreement will change, right? And so there's been this demand for the work from the workers that it's obviously the time is up. These are now the dominant players in the industry. I mean, Amazon, Netflix, these are the new power. And so it really doesn't make a lot of sense for them to be able to not contribute as much to pensions, to pay workers less, things like that.
Yeah. And generally speaking, there's been a lot of talk about the labor shortage right now, the increased leverage that workers, whether they're unionized or not, have in demanding better conditions. But there's also been, there was an article in today's New York Times talking about the number of workers who, as a result of the pandemic, no longer feel they need to be chained to a 9-to-5 job. Could you talk about how the labor movement itself is being transformed as a result of the pandemic?
Yeah, absolutely. So we see this reflected, right, even among non-union workers in what people are calling the Great Resignation. So the numbers came out from the Department of Labor recently that showed that in August, almost 3% of the U.S. workforce quit their jobs. So about 4 million or so workers, which is an enormous number of people who are saying, you know what, I'm sick of this, I'm leaving. A lot of those workers are trying to switch industries. A lot of them are finding better deals or trying to. They're trying to navigate the labor market themselves. But it really reflects a sort of reevaluation of priorities, right? I mean, workers I speak to all the time across various industries say that their experience during the pandemic showed them that it's not worth it to risk your life and the health of your family for a job, for an employer who doesn't treat you well, who might be willing to kill you, who might not take the right protections that you need to protect yourself from COVID. And so workers have said, especially, I mean, IATSE is a great example of this, but also those workers in the food manufacturing sector who've been on strike because they were being worked 80 hours a week. They said, you know what? A good life consists of family, of free time, of pleasure. It does not just consist of work. And if that's not a deal that's on offer, I'm not keeping this job anymore.
We're going to break. Alex, we want you to stay with us, though, as we look, speak with a worker at John Deere on the picket line, and also go right here to New York to speak with one of the main organizers of the taxi workers who, well, are facing an increasing number of suicides, dealing with massive debt, costly medallions as they try to compete with companies like Uber and Lyft and deal with New York City. Stay with us. There's power in the union. performed by street dogs. This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. As we continue our look at the strike wave in the United States, we turn to the strike underway by more than 10,000 John Deere workers at 14 plants, including 7 in Iowa, 4 in Illinois, 1 each in Kansas, Colorado, and Georgia. Today marks the 7th day of the strike, and negotiations resume Monday. Workers who are manning picket lines at the John Deere plant in Des Moines, Iowa, get a visit today from U.S. Secretary of Agriculture and former Iowa Governor Tom Vilsack, according to the United Auto Workers Local 450. For more on what workers are demanding, we go to Ottumwa, Iowa, to speak with Chris Larson, who has been out on the picket line. He's a painter at the Ottumwa Works Factory there at John Deere and has worked for John Deere for close to 2 decades. He's a former president and member of United Auto Workers Local 74. Chris, welcome to Democracy Now! Explain what the demands are. We're also with Alex Press, who writes extensively about strikes and workers across the country.
Well, good morning, Amy, Juan, and Alex. It's a pleasure to join you this morning. Basically, what we're wanting, we've seen a tentative agreement that we had a ratification vote on October 4th. We've seen a very paltry wage increase. We've seen no improvements to our incentive plan, no language to address any of the failings there. And really, the big non-starter for a lot of people was the fact that any new hires coming in after the 1st of November of this year would not be entitled to a secure defined pension, but rather a 401k pension or 401k match. And a lot of us are not willing to invest our retirement benefits for the kids coming in, the kids down the street on a Wall Street speculation portfolio. It might be important to note also that Deere's in the wake of record profits. They're projected to make between $5.7 and $5.9 billion this year. They just rewarded their CEO with 160% wage or salary increase. They gave their investors a 17% quarterly dividend hike back in August. And for a worker like me, over this next 6 years, right out of the gate, I make about $20 an hour, and it's going to be about a dollar wage increase for me. Followed up by at the end of the 6 years, about $2. What we're asking for is a fair shake and something equitable. I'd like to quote Walter Reuther here. We don't want a bigger slice of pie. We want a bigger pie. They need to come in with a bigger bucket of money, and let's negotiate.
And Chris, you mentioned the record profits at Deere. How has the company been able to achieve the profitability in the midst of what of the pandemic and the sharp downturn that occurred in the economy last year as a result of the shutdown?
You know, that's a great question. You know, for Deere workers, I mean, there was no shutdown. There was no lockdown during the pandemic. We came into work every day. We worked overtime, not only exposing ourselves, but our family, our friends. And, you know, at the end of the day, with the offer that was brought up, you know, we feel that it's very arrogant, audacious, and classist. And, you know, it's not going to cut it. That's why we sent a direct, clear message to Deere when 9 out of 10 workers voted to send them back to the negotiating table.
And you have been, there are generations of your family that have been a Deere. Could you talk about the importance of a company like Deere to the labor movement in the country in general?
Yeah, so, I mean, here in John Deere, Ottumwa Works, and as well as, you know, many other places that in John Deere, Waterloo, you know, Ankeny, the Quad Cities especially, you have generations that have worked there. Families that are very invested in this company. You have grandparents, parents, you know, children. If you walk down on the picket line, you'll see families. You know, it's a family event. You know, people have come down to support. And I'll tell you, the amount of support we've got from our community has just been amazing and overwhelming. So many donations from businesses, so many donations just from people on the street that'll come and walk our picket line. You'll see cars driving by, waving, honking in solidarity So we're really impressed and very thankful from the outpouring of support from the community.
And Chris, can you talk about the significance of the U.S. Agriculture Secretary Vilsack, former governor of your state of Iowa, coming to stand on the picket line, and then how the company is responding?
Well, I can't speak to how the company is going to respond, but we certainly appreciate Mr. Vilsack, coming to Iowa, walking our picket line with us. We've seen a large number of, politicians and people in the legislature come to walk the picket line and show their support. So, we're very grateful Mr. Vilsack's coming down and walking with us.
Well, I want to thank you, Chris Larson, for joining us, painter at John Deere Tumwa Works Factory in Iowa, member UAW Local 74, former head of the local, as we turn to New York. But before we do, to talk about the taxi workers, Alex Press, can you put the John Deere strike in context, for example, with a few of the other strikes that are going on right now, like Kellogg's?
Yeah, sure. So I think one important thing is that these are all private sector strikes. That's where the uptick is happening in the United States, which is very unusual. The private sector has far lower unionization rates than the public sector. Public sector workers right now are largely focused on negotiating safe return to work, things like that. So they haven't been striking as much. So the fact that private sector workers, who traditionally, historically have lower strike rates in recent years, are on strike is important. Also, the fact that these are different sectors. Different parts of the different industries within the economy. You know, we have food manufacturing. We have John Deere, obviously, is a separate industry. Healthcare workers, IATSE, obviously, also another different industry. So this reflects a real broad willingness to fight. I think also what's important here is what Chris mentioned, which is that the company wanted to create a two-tier contract on pensions. They said new hires are going to have a worse deal. And workers know that that is going to weaken their own union. It's not just about protecting future workers, but it's going to protect them, too, to refuse that kind of deal. And that's what we're seeing, is that companies think we're in an old moment. They think workers are willing to put up with whatever they're given. And workers know that the moment has changed. The pandemic, that decades of stagnant wages and nothing left to lose has made them willing more and more to fight back. So that is the picture of what's going on and why this could keep spreading.
We're going to turn now to yet another strike that's underway, this one in New York City, where a group of taxi drivers are launching a hunger strike today, demanding the city enact debt relief for thousands of drivers who've been devastated by massive debt accrued largely due to the artificially inflated cost of taxi medallions. This comes after taxi drivers held a 30-day round-the-clock protest outside City Hall. Drivers have also been denouncing the mental health impacts triggered by the financial ruin. At least 9 drivers have died by suicide. This is striking New York City taxi driver Richard Chow speaking Tuesday to Democracy Now!
I'm driving for the yellow cab for 16 years. I'm fighting for this hunger strike. This is very important for us because we are fighting for not only for my loan, we are fighting for the 6,000 medallion owner are devastating. We're struggling, the financial hardship. We lost everything because of the city's neglect us, the city program and the TLC program is not happening up because we are under the water so many years. So we are fighting for this crisis so we can save the 6,000 medallion owner and plus their family, we can survive. So this, my brother committed suicide, 9 drivers committed suicide. Because this fight is very important for us. I don't want to see another driver commit suicide like my brother Kenny Chow. That's why we must win this fight and we can survive.
For more, we're joined by Bhairavi Desai, the executive director and founding member of the New York Taxi Workers Alliance, the union that represents thousands of taxi drivers in New York City. Bhairavi, welcome back to Democracy Now! Can you talk about the dire situation faced by taxi drivers in New York?
It's just been really devastating. I mean, we've had 9 driver suicides. And at this point where drivers have an average debt of $550,000, the city is basically no solution. They've come out with what's really just a cash bailout to the banks with no real relief for the drivers. Thousands and thousands of families are going to be left in a debt that it will be beyond their lifetime, and they'll be earning below minimum wage just to pay it off.
And Bay Review, I'm wondering if you could talk about the how the crisis got to this this spot, where basically at one point, I think under the Bloomberg administration, they were selling, they were auctioning medallions at more than $1 million each. How was it that that this huge debt piled up on so many taxi drivers?
Yes, so the city of New York issues the medallions, and the medallions are just the number you see on top of the cab. They are the permit that allow yellow cabs to have exclusive street hail rights across New York City. The Taxi and Limousine Commission sets what's called the opening bid when they auction off new medallions. 2013, they set that opening bid at $850,000. This crisis really, the scandal really goes back to several years now. After 9/11 and the economic impact, the Bloomberg administration started to auction off medallions to raise revenue for the city. In the process, they raised over $855 million off the backs of the drivers. 7 government agencies noted that the city inflated the value of the medallion. The Taxi and Limousine Commission did direct mailings and advertising campaigns to almost, you know, predominantly immigrant driver workforce. And then the same officials allowed in Uber and Lyft without regulations, which really crashed the market. And so between 2011 and 2019, drivers adjusted for inflation saw a decrease of 44% of their earnings. Meanwhile, these expenses have remained completely fixed. And so that's why they are in such deep underwater. This is day 31 that we've been out on the streets, a 24/7 protest, but we've yet to hear from our mayor.
Now, the mayor, Mayor de Blasio, had much support from the taxi and limousine industry when he ran for mayor, but he promised to try to resolve the crisis facing the yellow cab driver. What's he actually done?
Well, you know, it took 3 years for the city to pass what's called a cap on the number of vehicles, because we all know that central part of Uber and Lyft's business model has been to flood the streets with cars. By the time the vehicle cap was passed, there are already more than 80,000 vehicles on the road. And then today, when there's an average debt of $550,000, the mayor had tasked his taxi commission to come out with a program, and all they could do was come out with a $20,000 grant program where, according to their own rules and regulations, the banks and private equity firms could even charge as much as $2,000 a month to a driver, leave drivers at even $500,000 in debt. You know, there's no solution. And the second part of their proposal is a $9,000 subsidy, you know, because they themselves know that they're leaving drivers. It's a setup for failure where drivers are not going to be able to pay off these debts. And so they're agreeing to subsidize drivers' payments for a year. We're not looking for subsidies. We're looking for real relief so people can get on with their lives. I mean, besides the suicides, we have seen so many members that have died an early death, and so many drivers that have had strokes that are now permanently paralyzed. I mean, widows of drivers who are retired and, you know, thought that they left behind an asset now have a payment that's even more than their Social Security monthly income. I mean, this is a dire crisis of poverty. We have a solution that's been endorsed by the Senate Majority Leader Chuck Schumer, the entire New York City congressional delegation, over 70 state and city elected officials, and popular support, you know, across the city among New Yorkers. And yet the mayor is not even meeting us at the table to discuss a proposal that will cost the city of New York less than $3 million a year. Mind you, the city has a budget of an annual $100 billion. They took $850 million off the backs of the drivers. Our proposal will cost the city less than $3 million to bring our people out of poverty and a debt beyond their lifetime.
Myra, very quickly, many people may see this as the New York taxi drivers versus the Uber and Lyft drivers. Maybe it's versus Uber and Lyft. But actually, the number of Uber and Lyft drivers are in solidarity. Is that right?
Absolutely. During our 24-hour camp, many of our Uber and Lyft members have come out, stood in solidarity. Some have even stayed overnight during the late hour shifts. This is a worker issue. This is a labor issue. Fundamentally, this is also an issue of democracy, where City Hall, we've been camped outside the gates of City Hall. They haven't even had the decency to come and speak to us, even though the city is centrally responsible for this crushing crisis.
Well, we want to thank you so much for being with us. Bhairavi Desai, New York Taxi Workers Alliance, speaking to us from here in New York City. Next up, we're going to Buffalo to speak with the Democratic mayoral candidate, India Walton. She's a Black nurse and mother of four who's trying to become the first socialist mayor of a major American city in decades. She won the Democratic primary against the four-term incumbent. But the New York State Democratic Party is not supporting her. We'll find out why. Stay with us.
You cease to smell the steel plant after you lived here for a while. Smoke is snow, is ash or leaves that blow through the air aloft. And all our houses dim their siding to the same soot gray style. And we hang our laundry out on Sundays when they turn the furnaces off. And everybody's daddy works up on the line. The Steinbrenners and the Wachowskis have been here the longest time. And everybody's mommy squints into the sun. Sunday afternoon after all the laundry's done.
Trickle Down by Buffalo, New York's Annie DeFranco, about growing up amidst the looming fear of factory shutdowns in her hometown. This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. The chair of New York's Democratic Party is facing calls to resign after he compared Buffalo mayoral candidate India Walton to former Ku Klux Klan leader David Duke. Walton shocked the Democratic establishment in June when she defeated the Buffalo four-term mayor Byron Brown in the Democratic primary. India Walton is a Black single mother. She's a registered nurse, a longtime community activist, and a self-described socialist. But many of the state's top Democrats, including Governor Kathy Hochul and Senator Chuck Schumer, are refusing to endorse her in the general election. The Buffalo mayor, Byron Brown, is now running a write-in campaign in an attempt to stay in office, but she already defeated him. On Monday, the chair of the state's Democratic Party, Jay Jacobs, was asked by Spectrum News about why many Democrats are not endorsing Walton.
Let's take a scenario very different, where David Duke, you remember him, the grand wizard of the KKK, he moves to New York, he becomes a Democrat, and he runs for mayor in the city of Rochester, which has a low primary turnout, and he wins the Democratic line. I have to endorse David Duke? I don't think so. Now, of course, India Walton isn't in the same category, but it just leads you to that question, is it a must? It's not a must.
That was Jay Jacobs, the chair of the New York State Democratic Committee. He later apologized because of enormous outcry. Congressmember Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez responded by tweeting, quote, Jay Jacobs absolutely should resign over his disgusting comments comparing a black single mother who won a historic election to David Duke. India Walton is the Democratic nominee for mayor of Buffalo. No amount of racist misogyny from the old boys club is going to change that, she said. AOC will be heading to Buffalo Saturday to campaign with India Walton. This comes as nearly 2,000 nurses at South Buffalo's Mercy Hospital are on strike, one of many strikes underway nationwide this month, and India Walton is a nurse. With Election Day less than 2 weeks away, we go now to Buffalo, where we're joined by India Walton. If she wins in November, she'll be the first mayor of a major American city in decades who identifies as socialist. India Walton, welcome to Democracy Now. Congratulations on your victory in the Democratic primary. Are you also calling for the head of the state Democratic Party to resign? And talk about what your platform is.
Good morning, Amy. Thank you for having me. I'm hyper-focused on the next week and a half, approximately a little more than that, and winning the general election convincingly enough to let people know that the voters of Buffalo is who was calling for a change in leadership. You know, I think what Jay Jacobs said about me is unfortunate and misguided, but I'm definitely not focused on that. I don't have the energy. I don't have the space in my heart for too much anger, because right now I am running for mayor of Buffalo as an expression of love.
And India Walton, I wanted to ask you, you were not only a nurse, you were a union delegate of 1199 SEIU. Clearly, the labor movement was a big supporter of yours. How do you react, not so much to Jay Jacobs, but just to the refusal of the Democratic Party in general to endorse the candidate who won the primary?
You know, the way I see this race right now is a class struggle, right? We have the managers and leaders against the shop and the workers. And as a union delegate, I would often experience that dichotomy. We didn't always agree. The members didn't always agree with the leadership, and that's fine. And I think I have the benefit and the honor of being a boots on the ground organizer who was able to go into neighborhoods, into communities, knock on doors and have conversations with the people who matter. And that's the voters. So while, you know, I it's my hope that established Democratic leaders would endorse and support, that's not who I'm here for. I'm here for the voters of Buffalo. And I would add that, you know, the chair of my local party, the Erie County Democratic Committee, even though they endorsed my opponent pre-primary, they have come on board after I won and been true to their word of supporting the Democratic nominee. My assembly person, John Rivera, is in support. My county legislator, April Baskin, is in support. And my state senator, Sean Ryan, is also in support. So, you know, there's a few people who are publicly supporting, but more importantly, there are thousands of everyday working class Buffalonians who are going to come out to the polls and vote for me on November 2nd.
And you were not only a longtime labor activist, but you also were involved in affordable housing and through the as executive director of the Fruit Belt Community Land Trust. Could you talk about how your experience in fighting for affordable housing shaped your decision to run for office?
Yeah, the Fruit Belt Community Land Trust came out of that community's desire to stay in place, to protect homeowners from huge increases in their tax bills as a result of reassessments and rising rents. And, you know, the prior administration had a policy of demolition as a means to combat blight in the community. So there were 200 city-owned vacant lots in the Fruit Belt neighborhood that folks really wanted to put to productive use, but also use as leverage to get some community benefits from a growing medical campus that's adjacent to the neighborhood. And, you know, working in the Fruit Belt proved to me that the people know what they need where they live, And the people closest to the problem are closest to the solution, and experiential expertise, living the life of an everyday person, is enough when you can enlist the help of experts and professionals and highly skilled folks to get the job done. Not only that, but approaching the city and trying to just purchase land to build affordable housing on and seeing how complicated that process was. And it was like, hey, like, this is what the community is asking for. We all know there's an affordable housing crisis, and to have very little cooperation from the city, who had all of the ability and all of the power to help us construct affordable housing to the benefit of the community, really was motivating to me to go ahead and run, so that we would finally have a compassionate and empathetic ear in City Hall to want to work along with community groups who are trying to do good and not work against them.
India Walton, I mean, this was an amazing victory on your part. You beat the four-term Democratic incumbent mayor, who's now going to—who's launched a write-in campaign against you. This reminds me very much of Cori Bush, who ran for Congress and who beat a real dynasty that went on for decades. So if you can talk about what you think is most different about your candidacy, and also, I mean, the striking nurses, you're a nurse in Buffalo, thousands are out on strike. Are you a part of that?
I often visit the picket line. I take water and coffee, and I support those nurses who are not only fighting for, you know, a fair wage and benefits, but really fighting for their lives and the lives of people in our community who deserve safe staffing ratios and who deserve to be prioritized over the profits of executives and companies who are bringing home millions of dollars and expecting the people who do the work to work longer hours, to suffer. We're facing a nursing shortage all over the country. And I'm very proud of the nurses at Mercy Hospital and of CWA and all of the solidarity from other unions and community members for standing with them. I'm super proud of that. But to the first part of your question, which I don't even quite remember what it was.
Your victory against Byron Brown really upset the Democratic establishment, and how you think, why you think your message so resonated.
Yeah, you know, we were out in the streets last summer protesting after the murder of George Floyd, and we watched Buffalo police push a 75-year-old man to the ground. He was bleeding from his ears. His name is Martin Gugino. And the response out of our city leadership was not only disappointing, it was embarrassing. The country watched that on national news, and our leader, our mayor, defended the actions of his police department. And he wholly ignored the cries for justice from protesters, from community members, from our own governor, who compelled him to put in place reforms in order to get state entitlements and funding. And that was the only reason why there was action taken on behalf of the city of Buffalo to address our policing issue. And that those reforms have been lackluster at best. So, you know, I felt personally like if he would ignore thousands of people in the streets the summer before last, now, that he would also ignore a campaign that was being spearheaded by those people. You know, I don't feel like I won the Democratic primary. I feel like the city of Buffalo won the Democratic primary because the strategy was to have boots on the ground, people on doors, people having conversations and really having a truly grassroots-based campaign, and that's what we did. Our campaign hasn't accepted any money from corporations or lobbying groups or large developers. All of our fundraising has been small-dollar, you know, grassroots from individuals who truly believe in what we're doing. I have a diverse group of supporters from many countries of origins, across socioeconomic status, gender identity, sexual orientation, educational attainment, working class, you know, well-to-do. It's just been an honor for me and impressive to see how this campaign has come together and continue to fight over the long haul. You know, a lot of us thought that we would have a reprieve after the primary and have a little room to relax a little, but this write-in campaign has kept us, you know, full steam ahead. And my team and my dedicated volunteers have been with me every single step of the way. And that's what this campaign is about.
India
about
Walton, Bernie Sanders called you on primary after you won the primary?
He did. I've spoken to him several times since the primary.
And your response when he first called?
I cried. Bernie Sanders is a person who I admire very much and who sort of gave me inspiration to be more involved in local politics.
Yeah, I'd like to ask you quickly about the Byron Brown continuing to try to run as an independent and some of the supporters of him, considering that he is still nominally a Democrat. Could you talk about the far-right Trump supporters who are backing him?
Buffalo is 65% Democrats. So anyone who's going to run a successful campaign for mayor here pretty much has to be a Democrat. But the values of our current administration have not displayed the values that I believe Democrats hold, which is putting people and workers and families first. But, you know, his campaign is being supported by members of the Republican Party, and not only members of the Republican Party, but known local members of white supremacist groups. Carried petitions to get him back on the ballot. Actually, the judge who placed him back on the ballot was appointed by 45. We know that he's actively colluding with Republicans in order to maintain his seat of power.
Can you talk about Judge John Sinatra and his support of Byron Brown, the far-right Trump appointee who I think you're referencing?
Mm-hmm. So John Sinatra is the brother of a local developer, Nick Sinatra, who is one of Brown's biggest financial supporters, who's also, you know, been found to owe back city taxes in the same cycle that the mayor then was featured in a promotion video in support of him. So the ties that bind are not very difficult to draw. This is something that pretty much every person in Buffalo who watches the local news is well aware of, but this is how power works. Those with money and those with power are able to manipulate the system, skirt the rules, but ultimately I believe that justice will prevail. And in this case, a panel of appellate court judges decided that he could not be on the ballot. So he's using a lot of money and independent expenditures funded by the real estate lobby to continue to stoke fear among voters and smear me personally. But I don't think it's gonna work.
Well, India Walton, we're going to continue to follow your race. Democratic nominee for mayor of Buffalo. If she wins in November, she'll be the first mayor of a major American city in decades, back to 1960, who identifies as a socialist. Early voting starts on Saturday. That does it for our show. But, Juan, before we end, I wanted to give you the last word.
Yes, Amy. I'd like to take a moment to acknowledge the considerable criticism we received last week from viewers over comments that I made during an interview segment on U.S.-China conflict over Taiwan. In the prelude to a question, I remarked that Taiwan is an integral part of China and always has been. And while Taiwan was indeed a province of China for hundreds of years during the imperial era, it is also true that a vibrant movement for Taiwanese self-determination and democracy has long existed, one that's independent of great power conflicts. My apologies to supporters of that movement for failing to recognize that reality. And next time we discuss Taiwan, we'll be sure to invite experts that can more fully delve into that history.
Well, that does it now for our show. And just a couple things. Democracy Now! Is currently accepting applications for two full-time jobs, director of finance and administration, and a human resources manager. You can learn more and apply at democracynow.org. Democracy Now! Is produced with Renee Faust, Mike Burke, Dina Guzder, Messiah Rhodes, Nermeen Sheikh, Maria Terracena, Tammy Warnoff, Trina Nadura, Sam Alkoff, Tamaria Studio, John Samuel Hamilton, Rabbi Karen, Honey Masood, and Adriano Contreras. Our general manager is Julie Crosby. Special thanks to Becca Staley. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez.